Sean Carney, you're the Chief Design Officer at Philips.
Yes.
What does a Chief Design Officer do?
Okay, so I basically run design across Philips. So we've got around 700 designers working in Philips across our three big sectors, so lighting, healthcare, consumer. And with a number of different disciplines, we have 36 different disciplines within design. So it's everything from visual design, interaction design, product design, industrial design, going right through to ethnographic researchers, people researchers, and things like that.
So it's a big, a broad spectrum. This is your thing, yeah.
And we're designing the product, but increasingly over the last few years, we've moved from just designing a singular product to thinking about a complete ecosystem of connected product. And the thing that connects those products is data and services. So we're having to grow our capability very quickly around digital capabilities.
Yeah. Can you give an example of that? Because like you say, in the past you made products,
yeah,
and now you have to think in ecosystems, so things that are connected. Can you give an example?
Yeah, I mean, the Hue lamp is actually a great example of that. So, you know, we're the number one lighting manufacturer in the world, and we had a very, you know, for 125 years, we were able to build light fixtures and then sell bulbs. And every few months or years, the bulbs would blow, and then you'd provide a new bulb. So a very nice recurring revenue model.
Yeah.
With LED, the LEDs don't wear out. You know, they could be there 15, 20, 25 years or more. So we have to figure out new ways of creating value for our customers, which will earn us money. And by connecting the lights to the internet and allowing people to personalize experiences, customize experiences, we're able to command much more of a premium and deliver value to the customers, but also deliver value back to the company as well.
So where is that new business model then? Where do you make the money in the new situation?
Well, going forwards, we'll increasingly see people paying to download, let's say, certain apps. So for Hue lights, for connected lighting, it could be that you're enhancing the learning environment so your children will focus more as they're doing their homework in the evening. Or it could be it's helping you overcome jet lag or helping you wake up in the morning and live a healthier life. So that's another big focus for Philips right now, is making sure that on the one hand, yes, we deliver deep domain knowledge around healthcare. We're in the hospitals, we're supporting clinicians. But then in your home, we want to keep you living healthy. And colored light can have a major psychological and physiological impact on your wellness. And by connecting the lights, we can keep we can offer personalized experiences that will help you live a healthier life as well.
So do you then pay for a subscription or something, or do you extra on top of the?
Yeah, in the short term, and this is where kind of open innovation comes in. By opening an SDK and opening our APIs, we allow third-party developers to come in and develop unique applications, which they'll earn money on in terms of being able to offer these personalized experiences.
Yeah. Open innovation. Over here, a couple of hundred developers are working with the data sets, the APIs of seven or eight companies. Why is something like this important?
Yeah, I think, you know, we know what we know in a large enterprise organization.
Yeah.
And we've got people who've been doing this kind of work for many, many years. But when we, for instance, with Hue, opened up the APIs, we got use cases we could have never imagined by allowing people who are outside of our business, outside of our normal customer base, to come in and look at the potential of this technology and find new ways of exploiting the technology to deliver value to people. And so this isn't, so beyond colored lighting, of course, we're into a lot of healthcare devices. And then we've got some slightly different issues where we've got to deal with privacy, security, patient data. But by, again, making data available and opening our company to partner with different people, we're able to scale much quicker, we're able to find new applications and bring learnings from industries we wouldn't have imagined into helping us deliver a better experience. As an example there, we know that in the clinical field, in patient field, if you sit opposite your doctor, you hope your doctor is fully informed about all of your ailments, but also all of your treatments, which are pertinent to a particular complaint you've got. It's actually quite difficult to aggregate all the data that's coming from different places. Now, if you've had, for instance, x-rays at the dentist, and you've had a CT scan and another x-ray in a hospital for an accident and emergency, you're probably approaching your limit of the amount of x-ray that you want to be exposed to. Now, if your clinician sees all of this on one dashboard, then they can make informed choices about the right kind of treatment that you should be having, because they've understood just what you've been subject to so far. So I think there's a lot of potential there to work with third parties in how we bring that data to life. And an example there is that we partnered recently with Salesforce.com.
Yeah.
Salesforce is basically a customer relationship management dashboard, streaming data about your particular customer. So as a salesman, when you sit opposite that customer, you know everything about them, what they've ordered, when it's being shipped, what's selling through, what the average price is and everything else. Now, if you turn that and make that data stream into healthcare data, medical data, then, and you're not a salesman now, you're a doctor, you can see the patient opposite you, and you've got a dashboard of all the information that's pertinent to that person. Now, the opportunity space right now is that we can combine that healthcare data with personal data, which is perhaps coming from wearable devices.
Yeah.
And that could be a connected weighing scale, or it could be a connected wristwatch, which is streaming real-life data about how you're living your life. And so, you know, if you put yourself as maybe a cardiologist, you can pull somebody into your consulting room, you can wire them up with an ECG and EKG, and you can figure out what's going on at that moment in time. If you've got personal data that's being collected over the course of, let's say, a month, you know how they're sleeping, how frequently they're exercising, you know what their average heart rates are, what the temperature has been, if they're hydrated, all sorts of other data, you could now build a really good picture of how healthy this person is. And when an episode occurs, you know, what was the indicators, what were you doing at the time that actually happened?
Yeah.
So I think that we're at the point of a big breakthrough in terms of the amount of data that's available. And as Philips, as most large organizations, I would say, not only Philips, we know we can't own all those data points, but what we can do is create value from aggregating that data, from being able to pull data from different people and then make value of that for the particular customer.
Yeah. So how difficult has it been for Philips as a company to go from that product company to a company that talks about ecosystem where data is more important than ever? How difficult has
that
been?
I'd say it's a mix. And it varies because we're a very large business, 120,000 people around the world. And I think if you break it down, we're about 45 different businesses. And on the one extreme, you maybe have a light bulb manufacturing company that knows everything there is to know about light bulbs.
Yeah.
But then you've also had pockets of the company that have developed in an open innovation way, things like the Blu-ray format, the CD formats. They've also been party to developing the open platforms around MPEG and JPEG and platforms like this, where we couldn't do it all ourselves. In order to get scale, we had to partner with other large organizations in these spaces. We built cloud platforms in the past, before it was called cloud, for connected TVs, connected Blu-ray, connected entertainment. And this has been the basis of our smart TV. Now we're able to take those technologies and repurpose them towards healthcare, towards connected lighting, and ultimately to also provide a base for wearable devices as well.
Yeah. So what sort of a different characteristics does your personnel need now, say, when you compare it to 10 years ago?
Yeah, they really have to be able to look at how can we enable open innovation? What information and data do we need to present in what format that we encourage third parties to come and want to join our platforms and co-develop some of these experiences? So it's not just about putting opening up your APIs or putting an SDK out there. you've also got to nurture the community and develop the relationship with the developer community. Which means we've got to use empathy skills. We've got to understand what's going to motivate people to actually come and use our APIs or build onto our platform in order to create these experiences. Yeah.
So do you have sort of community managers for that?
Or? Yeah, I mean, that's, again, a new job that's emerging. In the past, you would have, you know, marketing managers, marketing directors, but they're dealing with either customers or consumers, building demand. But now you've got those community manager roles that are emerging where we know they've got to really engage with the developer community in order to get the traction and get people using our APIs and start creating new experiences.
Yeah, because that's what a lot of people of the companies, and I assume Philips as well here, have been doing, because you need to help them a little bit about what's in that API, so yeah. Give them sort of ideas.
Well, listening to feedback as well, because no use just putting them out and then hoping everybody's going to figure it out. You know, this community is actually really good at telling you what's good, what's not, what sucks, and you better be listening, because they're also very unforgiving if you're not listening. They'll openly talk about you in the community, and that goes viral very quickly. You know, yeah. good news spreads, but bad news spreads even quicker. Yeah. So if you're getting bad ratings on an application, that's something you need to react to. But equally, if the developer community is seeing holes in your APIs and they're not happy with the support you're giving them, they'll also talk about it openly, which will give you a bad feeling in the community.
Yeah, you've been a part of the first jury round. Yeah. So what was your impression?
Yeah, some interesting use cases. It's interesting to see how people are combining APIs and experiences across different partners here. Some of the interesting ones for me were they're using Philips Hue, and they're taking data feeds from areas like maybe Transavia or Schiphol Airport, and even using them with data feeds coming from Albert Heijn. So. A really nice one I like an awful lot was taking data in terms of people coming into Schiphol, landing. They're waiting at the luggage belt for their luggage. How can we enhance that experience? So it was basically understanding the country they'd arrived from, then using the coloured light to replicate the country they were coming from. It can be, you know, Mediterranean quality light, or it can be the colours of the flag. But then they were also pulling recipe recommendations and putting those on the screens and also on your device. Mm-hmm. And if you liked it, then you could actually have that waiting for you as you go through security to Albert Heijn. Yeah. So they've got the shopping bag to go. So if you've been in Spain enjoying paella for the last 2 weeks and you want to now try and make it at home, they can have that shopping ready for you as you leave the airport. So it takes that kind of downtime of waiting for your luggage and enhances that experience in a value-add way.
Yeah, remains fascinating, the speed of change and the speed of possibilities, mm-hmm. the change of possibilities we have now, because this is only in the, when you look only at the last 10 years.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, we've seen this sort of massive explosion in the number of handheld devices, the speed of the internet, the ability to collect data, and then to, you know, write algorithms that can interpret the data in meaningful ways. And it's just going up at a phenomenal rate. I think the big thing now is what happens as we connect devices, physical things, to that cloud and start to both collect data, but then also what can we do with the data? This is that kind of Internet of Things getting really physical and the web becoming physical. So leveraging big data to actually get actuators, and light bulbs is only one of the actuators that will react to data. But having physical objects, physical things now react to big data feeds as well.
What does this speed of change mean for your work as a chief design officer?
It means we have to build capability very quickly internally. our creative directors are no longer just the form givers and people looking at the making beautiful products or making compelling websites or apps. They've really got to think holistically. So we need people with deep domain knowledge around a particular discipline, but then we also need people who can think about an experience that bridges multiple touch points and multiple products, both inside the company and outside the product company.
Yeah, and in what sense can you think in, well, say, sort of living object? Because the world of software is a world we build something and we build something next week on top of it. The problem, of course, with products is that's not the way it works.
That's a real that's a really good point, because we're kind of in the software and UI world. We work in more agile kind of sprints, two-weekly sprints, things like that. We do a lot of kind of build it, test it, learn from that, and then iterate very quickly, which is fantastic. The challenge we've got is now, how do we bring that into the hardware world, which is traditionally stage-gated kind of waterfall methodology. And you've got, you know, products which have maybe a UI, which is being developed in agile manner, but if they're connected to a cloud-based service, then that's also going to be developed in an agile manner as well. And you can have kind of a different cadence that you're working with. And that's, again, one of the complexities we now have to build from a project management perspective. But essentially what we're looking to do is make the hardware world much more agile, which means we start to look at new technologies, you know, late dedication in a production line, more platforms, 3D printing technologies, using big data to fuel logistics, supply chain and demand, all helps us become a little bit more agile as we go forwards.
Yeah. Last question about things like this, the hackathon phenomenon, open innovation. Is that a hype, or is that a thing to stay?
No, I mean, we're actually doing these internally. So, you know, the method of kind of allowing people to come into a kind of an incubator, hotbed, hothouse, where you throw in a few problems, you give people access to data, to hardware and software, and then allowing them to focus for a small period of time and build things is something that we're running more and more internally. But as I said, it's also important that we open up and we allow third parties to come in. So I see it's not just a hype, I think it really is helping us accelerate innovation and get more meaningful innovation into the market in a shorter period of time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah.